Hi everyone, thanks for joining us tonight. I'm gonna go ahead and get started since it's past six. So thank you all for joining us today for the Exploring the Wilderness by Water Short and Long Swims in Oregon Lakes webcast. My name is Allie Fisher and I'll be your MC for tonight. I'm the Communications and EDI Associate at Oregon Wild. Tonight, I'm honored to introduce our very special guest, Jessica Kieras. She is an avid swimmer and delights in open water swimming, ultra distance swims, and even cold water swims. Hailing from Central Oregon, she's explored everything from wilderness waters to ocean swims, and her enthusiasm for it is contagious. She's chronicled many of her adventures in her blog, Oregon Lake Bagging, and will be recounting her most recent 13-mile swim at Waldo Lake. She'll offer a variety of wisdom for those of us who are more terrestrial inclined, including some tips on how to get started. Jamie Dawson, Oregon Wild's public lands campaigner, will also be discussing updates on Oregon's new Wild and Scenic Rivers Bill, the River Democracy Act, and what it means for water lovers across Oregon. I would also like to include a land acknowledgement in this space. I would like to offer gratitude to the land itself and for those who have lived here in Oregon since time immemorial. Not just the forests, rivers, mountains, and deserts that those of us at Oregon Wild celebrate and work to conserve, but also places of art, industry, science, commerce, and community that are built upon these lands. I would also like to acknowledge the continuing presence of Indigenous peoples on the land today, as well as historical events, including colonial legacies and wrongdoings like forced removal that have had long-lasting and current impacts. Additionally, a recording of this program will be emailed out tomorrow and will be posted on our website, OregonWild.org, in the Wild blog. Please enter your questions at any time. We usually do get a flood of questions right at the end of the presentation, so the sooner you can get yours in, the easier it will be for us to organize and answer these after our guest has finished presenting. If you got a raffle ticket, thank you. Your support allows us to continue doing these presentations and the other work that we do. And the raffle will be open through this evening. So if after the presentation you decide you'd like to enter, you can do that by finding this event on the OregonWild.org homepage. Winners will be selected soon and contacted by email to verify shipping addresses. Lastly, make sure to RSVP for our next webinar on Wednesday about first foods and life cycles, where we will be joined by Wenix Red Elk from the Confederated Tribes of the Umatilla Indian Reservation. She will be discussing life cycles and food preparation of native plants and animals like salmon, deer, elk, camas, biscuit root, and huckleberry. You can find this online at OregonWild.org. Now I'll pass it off to Jessica.
All right, can you guys see this okay?
Yeah, it looks great.
Okay, I'm Jessica Kieras. I'm gonna be talking a little bit today about exploring the wilderness by water. I'm going to tell you some of the things that I think are really special about swimming as a way of adventuring outdoors and talk about how I got into it and what led up to me getting to do a really cool adventure a couple weeks ago at Waldo Lake. And also talk about some how you guys can get into it more if you're interested in doing some open water swimming or if you're already doing some swimming and wanna maybe increase your distance. So I'm hoping to offer some tips in that area as well. Here's me. I'm a psychologist. I work with people who have anxiety and OCD, all different ages. I'm also really interested in land use planning, and so I volunteer at the Deschutes County Planning Commission. And this is my kind of regular daily swimming spot. I'm super lucky because this is just like a 5-minute jog down from my office and I can get in here and swim in the river. This is in Bend where I work. And sometimes if I have a long time, I'll stay in the river a long time. If I have a short time, I can just get in and stay in a short time. But I feel super lucky that this place is here. And in terms of swimming these days, I'm really into this thing called ultra swimming. So I'll talk a little bit about what that is. So ultra swimming is basically you're going from one geographical point to the next. In this particular swim, in this picture, I'm actually out there in the middle of the ocean swimming from Catalina Island to mainland California. You can see there's a picture of my route up there in the upper right-hand corner. But something that's special about ultra swimming is that you wear a swimsuit, cap, goggles, earplugs. You're allowed to wear lights because a lot of times the ocean swims happen at night and it's dark. The water is typically calmer at night, so that's why we do a lot of the swims at night. But other than that, it's really kind of, it's a very traditional, minimal gear. And the reason for that is because there's a strong value in the sport of connecting with the water, being as close as possible to the water, doing things the way people did them 150 years ago when the first person swam across the English Channel. There's a lot of respect for wildlife, kind of a conscientiousness about, you know, how are we impacting things. And, you know, it's kind of like an ultra running. Like if you're going to run a marathon, maybe you're running on pavement, like in the Olympics or any of the traditional style marathons. But in ultra running, you're dealing with all kinds of different terrain. You're kind of out there in the wild, so to speak. And that's kind of how we think of ultra swimming too. It's typically a longer distance, although, you know, like maybe something around 20 miles or so. Some people go a lot further than that, a lot longer swims. We actually had somebody swim four ways across the English Channel a couple years ago, which is really incredible. So it comes in all different types of distances. And one of the biggest challenging things about it actually is that you have to be able to deal with really cold temperatures in the water, or even slightly cold temperatures for a really long time. And in some cases, people who like to do warm water swims, you have to learn how to deal with warm water. And so that requires your body to adapt to different things over time. And as a result of that, we end up swimming, daily, all four seasons, year after year, as a way of getting that experience and causing the body to adapt to the water itself and the conditions that the water is presenting. So it's really an immersive experience. I mean, literally an immersive experience. And anytime you're immersing into anything, whether it's, you know, in this case, water or different culture, you start picking up on nuances of things, subtle changes, and kind of what the environment actually feels like to you subjectively. I think probably one of the most obvious ones is temperature. So I and my friends, anyone who does this regularly, can usually tell the temperature of the water within a degree after being in it for a few minutes. So I can get in the river and say, oh, it's like 62 today, or oh, this is 64 right now. Whereas, I definitely couldn't do that before I started doing this. Some of the more subtle things you notice are like the smell or the taste of the water, certainly the texture. So in a really cold, when the water is really cold in the winter, it actually has a different texture than it does when it's not as cold. And of course, it's also influenced by, you know, if there's algae in the water or different other types of nutrients, or, it's more turbid. That actually feels really, really different than when it's super crystal clear, like Waldo Lake or some of the other very clear lakes that we have around here. Here's an example. This is Lake Billy Chinook in the dead of winter. The pools were closed a big chunk of the winter, and plus when they were open, you could only swim for like 40 minutes anyway. And so some of us took to swimming year round. This was my third year swimming year round, but I know some other people who did it for their first year this time. And on this day, the water actually felt quite kind, whereas the air temperature was 18 and it was very mean. Getting out was not fun, but getting in pretty intense. But once you were in, we stayed in for 23 minutes. It was really special. We swam out just a little ways. You don't want to swim out too far if it's cold, obviously. And this is in the crooked arm of the lake. And we were looking down into the canyon and the snow was falling. And me and my friend were just kind of grinning at each other. Wow, this is just really, really cool. And so I don't encourage people to start with this type of experience, but my point is it's not like I'm somebody special or anything like that. 3, 4, or 5 years ago, 64 degrees was like really cold to me. And it just was a matter of process and time and patience to be able to have a really cool experience like that. A contrast, here's Lake Billy Chinook last summer. Sorry for the blurry picture. But in this swim, I went all the way around the lake, kind of another long swim, but you can see the water, it looks very different. If we go back to this one, it's actually super clear. You can actually, in that bottom right-hand photo, you can see that, I mean, that the bottom that you can see in that photo is actually like, you know, far deeper than where I can touch. So like, I don't know, maybe like 10, 15 feet down there. Whereas here it's green. So I'm not sure why it was green that day, but it usually is around that time of year, starting in June, maybe May or so, it gets that color, and whether it's pollen or an algae bloom, hopefully not a toxic algae bloom since I was in there for 13 hours, but nothing bad happened. So so quite a contrast, same lake, same place in the lake, but totally different experience. So here's Waldo. So a lot of you guys probably know or have been to Waldo, either paddling or swimming or maybe running or mountain biking around the lake. But for those who don't know, this place is just incredible. Thanks to Oregon Wild and other conservationist groups, there are no gas-powered motorboats on the lake, which is very unusual for a large lake. And you can really feel the difference. So a lot of people like to compare Waldo to Lake Tahoe, which I've also done a swim across. And Lake Tahoe is pretty awesome, but it has tons of boats and it also has a lot of development around the shorelines. And it does feel different to me. I was kind of prepared to be there and kind of have a Waldo-like experience, and it wasn't quite the same, even though, you know, you never want to say anything negative about Lake Tahoe. It's pretty special. So at Waldo, there is no development except for the campgrounds and the day use areas, which are on the east side. And then we have wilderness, north, south, west. There's a trail that goes around it, to places that you can camp, and then a ton of other really nice lakes. The sensory qualities there are like, it's like clearer than clear, and you can see down really far. Really, really bright blue, sapphire water, turquoise in other places when you get closer to the edges, and it's probably due to the green from the trees. It tastes very clean. Like, you can't help but kind of drink some water when you're swimming for a long time. You kind of get a taste for the water. There's none of the metallic taste that you taste in some other places, or like the earthy taste that you taste in other places. There's just no smell. Very quiet. With lakes that have motorboats on them, you hear kind of a mosquito sound. It's like a buzzing. And that's how you know there's a boat nearby, and you kind of need to look out for that. But there's just no sound, it's nice and quiet. And sometimes we talk about personalities of water. And so you wanna be kind of more spiritual about it. I experienced the water there to be kind of like ancient and wise, very welcoming, gentle, peaceful. It's just a lovely, lovely place to swim. So how did I get started with this? Thanks to these great people here. This was my open water swimming group when I lived in Eugene. And we would just go on these swims that were, we call them adventure swims. And, you know, people just kind of get together. That's me with the orange thingy. That's called a tow float. or a buoy. Sometimes we call it a buoy, but we can talk talk a little bit about that in the safety section, but that's what it looks like. You tow it behind you in case you want to have some extra reassurance or something while you're swimming out there. And it's also very helpful to let boats know that you're there. But when I first started swimming with these guys, everybody in this picture thought it was crazy, quote unquote, for wearing a wetsuit with no sleeves. And this was in August, so the temperature was like in the mid 60s. And we would do this route here from, you can see the yellow line there from the campground, the Shadow Bay campground, to Rhododendron Island. And it would take, you know, 45 minutes, an hour, whatever, to get there. And then we would sit on the island and eat lunch and then swim back. And I remember wearing that wetsuit and just like shivering on the island while I was trying to eat my lunch. And then now, after five, six years of doing this colder swimming, I've been able to get to the point where I could swim all the way around the lake. Like I'll show you the route in a minute, but not have any shivers at all when I got out. So the body's kind of gets more comfortable as you go. So let's see. So by 2018, I had already moved out here and I was really getting interested in more cold water. And so I was starting to push my limits a little bit with that. And I decided that it would be really cool to make up like a fun route around all three islands, starting at the Shadow Bay where that arrow is on the slide, Shadow Bay Date Use Area, going up to the North Island, going around that and then over to Rhododendron Island there on the west side of the lake, and then go due south to the South Island and then back to the day use area. We thought, you know, we should probably figure out how to navigate this because we didn't really know that you could get a GPS app for your phone. We just thought, I don't know what we didn't have any. We're like, what's GPS? We don't know how to do that. And when I say we, I'm speaking of my kayaker, who's my boyfriend. He was in that first picture with the Catalina Island. It's we'll talk about this a little bit later, but it's really nice to have a kayaker with you if you're going on like a longer swim. And so we were discussing this and we decided to do a practice swim. So we got in, we did just the bottom part, like from the start to the Rhododendron Island down to the Southern Island, and we actually missed our turn into the inlet where the day use area is. We thought it was just some random bay, so we're like, oh, we don't need to do the bays, we'll just go straight back. So we skipped the next bay and then the next bay, and we wound up at that point there in the middle. And we were like, oh, this is that, we're all the way back at the point now. And by that point I was getting cold. And so I luckily had packed a dry bag full of dry gear and warm clothes and that stuff. And so we just pulled over in the bay and I put on my flip-flops and all my warm clothes, got out of my swimsuit, and I just walked back to the day use area and Dan paddled back and it worked out fine. And so I think it's always important to have an exit strategy if you're going to push your limits, like whether you're pushing limits with distance or you're pushing limits with temperature, it's always important to have a plan of if something goes wrong, what are you actually going to do with that? And I'll say more about that in a bit. So from there, we did the whole thing the next time we got in. And then we went back again in about a month later when it was quite a bit colder and stayed in a while and tried it then. And then the following summer, I swam around in the south part of the lake by myself for like 4 hours and then met up with Dan and we did it again. So that after that one, I actually was pretty cold. So that was in 2019, almost, I guess, 2 years ago now. So here is a slide about the swim that we did to make it official. So I don't know if you guys can see or if the bar at the top is obscuring the title, but this is where I decided that we should create an official route of these three islands in the lake. And the reason why I wanted to do this is because, so in ultra swimming, a lot of swimming is done solo, and you're sort of connected with these communities of people. We do have a few group swims, races, sort of loose, not a lot of us are super competitive with one another, But we do have some group swims, but a lot of it is just you and a kayaker and a pilot boat swimming across the English Channel or something like that. And we watch each other on these live tracking things and cheer each other on and that kind of stuff. But occasionally somebody wants to make like kind of a new route, because maybe the route they wanted to swim like the English Channel or swim around Manhattan Island, those are popular routes. Maybe it was all booked up that year, or it was COVID and you can't fly to England or whatever. So there's a lot of people making new routes these days. And I thought it'd be really cool to have an official route at Waldo Lake, because it's obviously an amazing place. And I thought this might be a good way to show off how awesome it is when we take the time and effort to protect water and make it, maintain it being as awesome as it is. And so I'm really hoping that documenting the swim and sharing it with the rest of the swim community will just kind of set a good example in case there's other people out there that, you know, maybe want to move in that direction for some of their local waters. Some of the things that you need to document to make a swim official are the water and air temperature, wind speed and direction, stroke count. You got to count how many, like somebody has to count how many strokes you're taking in a minute periodically, get some photos and videos so that they, you know, they can kind of see, oh yeah, here she is going around this island and here she is going around that island. The route also has to be a repeatable route. It can't be like you just swam around in the lake for a while. Which, I mean, of course, you're welcome to swim around the lake for a while, always. But if you want it to be an official route, it has to be defined by geographical landmarks, which is what we have here in the picture on the right-hand corner here. The landmarks are the islands. Here's an example of the notes that my observer took. She was writing on this cool, it's called Write in the Rain. It's like a waxy paper. It's pretty awesome because I apparently splash a lot. Here's some pictures from the trip. By the way, I'll go back to that slide, but here's the crew. And that's Mary Louise sitting in front and then Dan sitting in back. And this was special too, because most swims are done with a motorboat as a pilot boat, most of these long swims. And the observer can ride, the person taking the notes can ride in the boat and not have to paddle or do anything like that while they're taking notes. And I also kind of wanted to show that you don't actually have to do a motorboat. In this case, Dan just did the paddling and Mary Louise rode in the front of the kayak and did the note taking. She also was taking the pictures. So on the upper left here, we've got me heading out through the big blue area. On the way to the North Island. In the lower left, that's the island that's near the North Campground. You can see the water looks kind of turquoisey there, or maybe aquamarine. And then here on the middle lower one, we have when I got to Rhododendron Island. And then also up top on the right-hand side, that's actually me drinking out of my water bottle. So periodically they'll throw me a water bottle and then I drink from it and then it's attached to a line and then I can just keep swimming and then they pull the water bottle back in. And then the final one is that last island with the green grass in the lower right hand corner. That's the Southern Island. So there's the crew. They're awesome, very awesome people. So that was the Waldo trip. It was a long time in the making and I'm hoping that some other swimmers will want to do it. And in fact, there is another swimmer who's interested in doing it this year. And she actually got started with marathon swimming by helping other people. She was like not a marathon swimmer. She wanted to get on other people's crews and help them. And then eventually actually became a really good swimmer. She swam across the length of Lake Tahoe last summer. And now she wants to come and do Waldo. And so if anyone's interested in helping with that swim, get in touch with me. I'll tell you how to do that later. But it's actually a great way to get started is help with other people's swims. And then you kind of get the hang of it. And she was kind of listening and taking notes and absorbing everything. And she's like, you know what? I think I could do this. And here she is doing it. So speaking of all of that, here's some stuff that you need to get started. Equipment, you definitely want to have, well, I guess not necessarily, but many of us prefer to wear a swimsuit while we're swimming. Swim cap, you don't have to wear a swim cap, but it is nice. It retains some heat and keeps your hair out of the way if you have longer hair like I do. Goggles and earplugs are also, of course, optional, but if it's under 60, it's important to wear them because you can get what they call surfer's ear, where the little tiny bones in your ear actually grow. And it can cause hearing loss and it requires surgery to fix. So I figure just wear earplugs and that way you don't have to deal with that. Plus it might help with swimmer's ear, which is an ear infection you can get from the water going in your ear. So not a bad idea. Some things that people like to have, especially when they're starting out, are toe float or a buoy, that orange thing that was in that picture, wetsuit, flippers, thermal hat. It's a neoprene hat, or they make neoprene gloves and booties. So a couple things about those. I think it's really nice to not wear a wetsuit because I really love being in full contact with the water, and I've seen how my body has adapted and gotten more comfortable with the temperatures. On the other hand, I started with a wetsuit and I'm kind of glad I did. It's a nice way to get started. I would say don't let the idea that you shouldn't wear a wetsuit, don't let that hold you back. Just, you can get one and practice with it and then take it off partway through the swim and practice without it. If you do get a wetsuit, do get a swimming style wetsuit, like one made for triathletes, because those are buoyant. They actually keep your body on top of the water. You really can't sink when you're wearing one, so it makes it a lot easier to swim. And then also, if you're anxious about being out there, it's kind of nice to know you can't really sink. You can do it in a scuba diving or surfing wetsuit. There's no rules against that. There are for the official ultramarathon swimmers who are not allowed to wear any wetsuit, but there's no rules about if you want to go to the lake, you want to just wear your surfing wetsuit, that's fine. It's just harder to swim. With the toe float, the buoy, I like to wear mine if there's any motorboats in the water. I don't like to go in the water without my toe float when there's boats. And that is because I'm afraid a boat is going to not see me and hit me. Ideally, I'm not really swimming anywhere where there's boats nearby. Even if it's a boaty lake, I'm staying near the shoreline, or I've got my kayaker with me who wears a bright red hat and has a flag on the kayak and all the other stuff. But I'm very paranoid about boats and jet skis because they don't really think they're looking for swimmers. It's nice, you can wear it wherever you want. The only thing I would say is if you're somewhere where you're swimming in the ocean and there's a lot of surf, all the ocean swimmers I know recommend that you do not wear the toe float in the surf, because when you go out under you need to dive under the waves to get out there. And if you try to do that, the toe float will stay on top and can flip you over, and I guess people have gotten hurt that way. So maybe not have the toe float if you're gonna try to swim through the surf. Okay, so a couple notes about anxiety. First thing to remember is that it's actually totally okay to feel panicky. Your heart can race. You can even get that gaspy, hyperventilating, overbreathing thing. None of that will actually hurt you. In fact, you know, when you're exercising, your heart rate's up really high. That's kind of the desired effect. So if your heart rate's up high, that's great. You're exercising. Good job. If you're hyperventilating, that's also okay. It will wear off. It usually peaks within about 10 or 20 minutes and then will get better. Sometimes it peaks faster than that. And if you do 3 to 5 swims under the same conditions, you're going to notice that it gets easier and easier and easier every time. And then once you're comfortable with whatever you're doing, then you can gradually increase it. You can go a little bit further from the shore or try it at a different temperature, and your confidence will just continue to go up. But the main thing is to be patient with yourself and realize that you're not in danger just because you're feeling really anxious. It's just unpleasant. It's not a fun feeling. The first time I ever went open water swimming, it was like, oh, this will be no problem for me, because I had swum in college and I was a good competitive swimmer and all that. But it turned out I was totally freaked out. Got to the middle of the lake. It was actually Darina Lake near Cottage Grove. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna die. What if there's something underneath me? And I had to swim about 5 strokes and then stop, kind of catch my breath, swim another 5 strokes, stop, catch my breath, swim another 5. And then I could get to 10 and stop, catch my breath, then 20. And then I was fine. And I swam across, swam, caught up with all my friends, and then swam back. And the next time I went out, I had a little bit of anxiety, but not much. And then by the third time, I was totally fine. And so not everyone's going to have exactly that story, but I just want you to know that if you do feel anxious or panicky, that's completely normal. And it happens to beginner swimmers. It happens to experienced swimmers. I still actually get some of it sometimes when I'm in colder water than I'm used to. And same thing, I just have to remind myself, you're panicking, it's going to be all right. Just, just take a second, swim a little more, take a second, swim a little bit more. So here's my giant safety slide. This is the Owyhee Reservoir here in the background. Absolutely special, super great, awesome place to be. Just the whole area is so cool. I went out there this spring and I didn't know exactly what to expect, but it was just really nice. So as I said, if there's boats, I like to stay near the shore or swim with a paddler. I always wear a really bright colored cap so that there's a little bit more visibility. And if I'm not gonna be, if I'm gonna be where there's boats, I wear my tow float. Sometimes even if, at Waldo, if I'm by myself, I'll wear the tow float just because there are sailboats, and sailboats might be going fast too, and also not looking for swimmers. And plus, I don't wanna mess up their day either. Who wants to be enjoying a nice day sailing on Waldo and hit up some random person swimming? So anything you can do to increase your visibility is a good idea. Also mentioned before, have an exit strategy. A lot of times people will kind of say, well, just never swim alone. And that might be a good idea, especially, when you're new at it. But that's not really sufficient, because you might be swimming out there with your friend. You might be totally in the middle of Lake Billy Chinook, where there's not there's cliffs. And, let's say you get too cold. How are you going to get out? I mean, it doesn't really matter that your friend's right there. Your friend could be like, you're all right. If you're panicking, that might be nice to have a friend, but the panic's not really dangerous and getting cold is. So it's really important to have an idea of how you're going to exit the situation if something happens that you're not comfortable with, or that's dangerous to you. So I've practiced clumsily climbing, scrambling on top of the sit on top that my boyfriend paddles. And it's not a comfortable ride back, but it would do in a pinch. It's nice to have a pilot boat if you're out in the middle of the ocean, of course. But if you're planning on getting out of the water as an exit strategy, it's nice to have a bag of dry clothes with you so that you're gonna get warm immediately. A couple things underwater to look out for: tree stumps, especially if you're gonna go to a place like Timothy Lake, where there's a bunch of trees that were cut down and then the lake filled in. There's just if you're staying on the shoreline avoiding boats, there's tons and tons of tree stumps that you can run into. So look out for that. Also near the shoreline are fallen trees. I bumped my head on a few fallen trees. Nothing bad happened. I'm okay. But it's not a pleasant experience. And of course, boulders, large underwater rocks, especially in the river, if you're going upriver from the Healy Bridge, there's a lot of large rocks and people have gotten scraped up on those swimming before. So I've said a lot about temperature. I just want to say a few things about safety on that. The most dangerous part is actually when you get into the water. Of course, you can get hypothermic, but it takes a really, really long time and it's gradual. And if you have an exit strategy, I think you'll be okay. But sometimes people will dive into water that's colder than what they are habituated to or acclimated to. And the problem with that is that you get the cold shock response where you suddenly inhale really strongly, like you gasp. That wears off after around, interestingly, 3 or 5 swims. But if you're diving into, let's say you're like, oh, I'm going to get in the river in the middle of the winter. River's like, last winter it was like 36 degrees. If you're going to dive in there, your body's going to go. And I guess my understanding is that you can actually inhale enough water to kill you. So it's really important to just go slow for safety. Gradually go into water that is colder than what you're used to, and you'll get the gasping response. That's totally fine because you're not inhaling water, your head's above the water. What I do is I get it up to my waist, then I get it up to a little deeper, and then I start with some head up breaststroke, and then I do some backstroke. So, you know, and then finally, when my body's more used to it, I put my head in the water. So 65 to 75, that might feel chilly at first. It did to me when I was new. It felt chilly at first, but I would kind of get used to it. As long as I was moving, I was fine. Your typical swimming pool, if it's like a serious lap swimming pool, is 80 degrees. I think in the Olympics, the pool is 78 degrees. So 75 and under is going to feel different and chilly to people at first. 60 to 65, usually pretty chilly for a new person. The 50s, most people kind of recommend that you kind of gradually build up, increase your duration gradually in the 50s. The 40s is when I think you can really run into some trouble because you get fast, you get cold really fast when it's in the 40s. So you're gonna, you know, maybe get used to the 50s first and then go to the 40s. A lot of people around here do a thing called riding the thermometer down. So they try to swim as much as they can daily. And as the water goes lower and lower, they get more and more used to the lower and lower temperatures gradually that way. I think it's probably easier to do that on the west side of the Cascades. The water gets cold, but it gets colder a little more gradually. Here it's like, one day the river is like 46, the next day it's like 42. And you're like, wow, that went fast. So it's a little harder around here to ride the thermometer down. Another thing to look out for that we have a lot of here this summer is toxic algae blooms. So this bottom side is Subtle Lake. And I think it was actually Subtle Lake in like September or something like that. I took the water temperature when I took this picture and it was 58. So I don't know why, because I thought that, you know, usually it's when the water is a lot warmer than that. Maybe it was warm and then it cooled off or something. I'm not sure why that happened. These other two pictures at the top are Little Lava Lake and Lava Lake just a month or two ago. So that's sort of what one of the things to look out for is when it looks like there's spilled paint on top of the water. But obviously in the top two photos, it doesn't look like spilled paint, but the water should be clear and it's kind of, well, it's very opaque. So that's maybe a warning sign. If it's a lake you're familiar with and you know that normally it's clear and it's not clear, I think that's something important to look out for. Here's some great places to go for first swims. There's so many great places. Just if there's a lake you want to go to, it's not on the list, don't worry about it, just go there. I probably could have listed all of the lakes as great first swims, but Dorena Lake, that was my first swim out, the open water swim, like I said, near Cottage Grove. Hag Lake is near Forest Grove, a popular swim spot for a lot of open water swimmers in the Portland area. Elk Lake, is probably the most popular, I think, for open water swimming around here. So far as I know, a lot of triathletes go up there. A lot of people just like to go up there and just do some swimming. One of the things I really want to emphasize is that you don't have to be trying to do some crazy long distance thing. You don't have to be a competitive swimmer. A lot of the people I know that are really passionate about this just enjoy getting in the water and going for a swim. Big Lake is really clear and really beautiful near here. also Cultus Lake, Waldo Lake. With those two, probably stay near the shore for a first swim. Cultus is really nice and very shallow for a long way out. So I thought that might be nice for people who, you know, like to have their feet underneath them or have the ground underneath them. Billy Chinook has a swimming area that people can swim in, and they also have a no wake zone. If you go early in the morning, there's fewer boats and that lake is warmer. I'm not sure about the algae bloom situation in the summer. I usually stop going around May or so, just because all these other lakes open up then. Deschutes River, if you go to Riverbend Park, you can get in the water there, and it's quite shallow. Just maybe swim upriver first to see, you know, if you go downriver, then, you know, you don't know, can you get upriver with the current? But if you go upriver first, then you'll kind of know. And of course, it's pretty shallow, so you can kind of walk back if you really needed to. That could be your exit strategy. And then, of course, East Lake and Polina Lake, I really love. East Lake is in the background here. East Lake gets a little bit of, I think, not toxic algae near the shore. It's just a lot of algae, and it's just kind of messy getting in and out toward the second part of the summer. Okay, so if you want to get in touch or read more about swimming or anything like that, I put my website on here. It's oregonlakebagging.wordpress.com. And I think there'll be some time in a little while for some questions, but I'm looking forward to hearing from Jamie about the River Democracy Act, which she'll tell you more, but it will be very helpful in protecting some of these really great lakes as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Jessica. That was super interesting. I have a lot of questions that hopefully some of y'all will ask, and she can answer them. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and, Jessica, can you turn your screen sharing off for me? Gonna hit that green button, awesome, thank you. So if you haven't met me before, I'm Jamie Dawson. I am Oregon Wild's public lands campaigner, and I'm based in Bend also. And this is gonna be 5 minutes or less so we can get to Q&A, but I just wanna introduce you really briefly to Wild and Scenic Rivers Act and the River Democracy Act, if you haven't heard of it already. If you're not familiar with Wild and Scenic Rivers Act, it is one of our, you know, special gems of an environmental conservation law that we have in this country. Something that I think is really special about it is that it's a little bit more flexible and a little bit more all-encompassing. So it essentially asks people across the country, you know, what waterways are important to you and for what reasons. And then those particular reasons or values are protected. Here's a great photo of Indigo Creek, a tributary to the Illinois River down in Southwest Oregon that's currently being proposed for protection under the River Democracy Act. So this is a bill introduced in February of this year by Senator Ron Wyden. This is a once in a generation opportunity to protect some of Oregon's most beloved waterways. And this came about through a pretty unique public nomination process. So Senator Wyden, over the last, you know, 2.5 years or so, reached out to Oregonians at town halls, online, and said, you know, what places are special to you and why, and had a public nomination process. And so 15,000 nominations came in for different river, creeks, streams, lakes, all around the state. And about 4,700 miles worth of them made it into the bill. So this is a really unique opportunity that Oregonians have. And it's not so too often, you know, that we get the opportunity to influence a bill this early on, you know, by giving direct input about what should be in it, and then that actually getting translated to bill language. One thing that I think is special about the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act is that it recognizes, you know, big, small, we need them all in the face of climate change and just, you know, wanting to have fully functioning watersheds. We need everything from, you know, headwaters, small streams where fish are spawning and rearing. We need these big, beautiful rivers like this Middle San Yam River, you know, and we need lakes and all different parts of the watershed. And so a couple examples of things that are in this bill, sections of the North Fork of the John Day River out here in Eastern Oregon, really big, beautiful, special river that's great for rafting. And it's also, you know, the John Day is one of the longest contiguous undammed river systems in the entire, you know, lower 48 United States. So a really special resource that we have here. Close to home, Tumalo Creek is something that is, you know, special to me. This is a recreation hotspot for us. It's really beautiful. If you've been to Bend, you've probably been here to Tumalo Falls. But this watershed is also part of Bend's kind of municipal city drinking water. So it'll protect it for both the recreation aspect and also for our drinking future, you know, the future of our drinking water. And then also lakes. Waldo Lake is one of the lakes in the River Democracy Act that's being proposed for protection. And of course, in Central Oregon, also Hosmer Lake, another really beautiful high mountain, you know, volcanic lake that it has incredibly interesting geology and is also obviously really beautiful. So where the bill is now and how you can engage with it. It was introduced in February. Senator Wyden has stated that he would like to get this bill passed by the end of this Congress. So that would be, again, don't quote me on this, but I think it would be, you know, January of 2023, however long this Congress ends. Right now, it's currently in a subcommittee. It just had its first hearing, which is a really exciting first step. That means that it actually has some momentum towards passage. And so what we essentially need to do now is just to make sure that Senator Wyden knows that Oregonians do continue to support his efforts to protect additional waterways in Oregon. So right now we are collecting signatures for a petition, calling it a citizen co-sponsor. And it's essentially just a list of names of people who say that they support protecting additional waterways in Oregon. So I'll go ahead and drop the link into the chat here in a minute. You can take a look at the text and see if it's something that aligns with your values. Hopefully it does. And hopefully you'll keep tracking this bill with us over time, because again, this is, I feel so honored to be working on something like this, because this is a once in a generation opportunity to protect not only lakes, but also headwaters of salmon streams, you know, rafting rivers and places that are important to all different types of people, you know, for longer than my lifetime and longer than yours. It's a very cool thing to be a part of. So with that in mind, and knowing that we've got some questions coming in here, I'm going to go ahead and stop screen sharing. And let's go ahead and get to the Q&A here.
All right. Thanks, Jessica and Jamie. So I'll get the Q&A started right away. So are there any local groups I can look into to meet other women who do both long and short distance lake swimming? Any info on groups for Black, Indigenous, and people of color is especially appreciated.
Great question. So a local, it depends on local, how local. There are a couple good ways to meet people. One way is to go to a master's swimming group in a pool. And master's sounds like it's like a scary, you know, like you have to be a master swimmer or something. Master's is an organization that tries to provide a swimming environment in the pool for all levels of swimmers. So it's not for master level swimmers, it's for any level swimmers. And sometimes when you attend a master's practice, particularly out here in Bend, we have a really large master's team and almost everybody likes to go open water swimming. And so if you're swimming with a lane of people who are about your speed, it's really great to be able to just say like, hey, is anyone going out to any lakes? Do you know anyone who likes to go lake swimming? So that's one way to meet people is start in the pool and meet people there and then transfer to the lakes. If you don't really want to go to the pool, like the pool's not your thing, you don't like chlorine, or just not, doesn't sound fun to you, then I would say another way, I've met a lot of people this way, and I know other people have met a lot of people this way. There is a Facebook group for, it's called Oregon Wild Swimming, no affiliation with Oregon Wild, but it is called Oregon Wild Swimming, and a lot of people post on there and say like, hey, I'm looking for a swim buddy to go to the Willamette River or the Clackamas River or Elk Lake this weekend, and sometimes you can hook up with people that way. So It's not a great example, a great answer. I wish there were a few better meetups, but I like going swimming with people. I'll go swimming with you. I think one thing is important is that, you know, like we don't tend to say with our friends, like with hiking, like, oh, like you can't hike with me because, you know, you're too fast or I'm slower than you. We're like, oh, let's go on a hike. You know, like it doesn't really matter if you're like a fast hiker or not. You just go on a hike with your friends. And I think that swimming can be the same way, as long as there's an understanding among people that, okay, we're going to swim out to here. Like I went swimming with my friend who's going to do the Waldo Lake swim in a few weeks. Like I went swimming with her in Waldo a while ago, and she's not at all my speed. And so I could just swim ahead and swim back and check in with her every 10 minutes or so. So as long as there's an understanding with people that we don't have to be together like constantly the whole time, like you can, I swim with people faster than me, swim with people slower than me. It's no problem at all.
Great, thank you. Those were some really great tips. Do you have any comments or tips on swimming in Shuttle Lake? This person likes swimming on the far western end where the wind chop is usually quiet.
So Shuttle Lake is a tricky one for me. One thing I didn't mention in the presentation is that I'm super sensitive to swimmer's itch. I mean, I'm like, I think the more you swim in lakes, the more sensitive you get. And so I'm way more sensitive than anyone else I know. And I don't swim in Shuttle too often because once it gets above around 62 or 63, it's just, there's a lot of swimmer's itch there for me. That being said, lots of people enjoy that lake, and I don't want to discourage anyone from going there because it's just a nice place. I think that Shuttle Lake is blue because of phosphorus, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know if anyone here maybe knows or wants to put in the chat, but rather than Waldo, which is blue because it's clear. Maybe that's why there's more algae there sometimes. I don't really have any other tips, but I like the one that you put in there about where to swim where it's less choppy. That's actually a good tip for everyone else. Thank you.
Great, thanks. I'm gonna combine a few questions here just to try to get through them. So how do you start researching for a new place to swim? And then somewhat related to that is how you prepare for and avoid lakes that have toxic algae blooms? Because I'm assuming you do some research on that as well.
Yeah, totally. So researching a new lake, the newest lake that I researched was the Hawaii Reservoir. I didn't, like I said, I didn't know what to expect. I did not know. I Googled a whole bunch to try to figure out what water temperature I might encounter when I got out there. And in the end, I didn't have a whole lot of expectation one way or the other. I figured if it was really, really cold, I just wouldn't stay in very long. And if it was really warm, I would stay in longer. But a lot of it was Googling. And then I just like went out there, and now that was my research. Now I know, okay, it was like, I think it was 60 or 58 or something like that in the beginning of May. So now I know, okay, if I want to go out and plan a longer swim, I can do that. For the algae question, I know that algae is more likely to happen when the water is warmer. And since I'm continually trying to train myself to be able to swim in cold water, I try to avoid water, and also because my swimmer's itch issue, I try to avoid water that's like over 65 in general, unless it's a ultra oligotrophic lake or something like that that's super duper clear. And then I know there's probably not going to be an algae bloom, and there's also probably not going to be swimmer's itch. So I'm kind of spoiled really by the lakes that we have here in being able to kind of count on there not being an algae bloom. That being said, I went up to Little Lava Lake in Lava Lake that day. I did not know there was an algae bloom. I got in, I swam for an hour and a half. I got out, I was about to get into Little Lava Lake and swim there. And then I cut my foot on a piece of glass, which meant that I like couldn't swim. It was not good. And also I was like, wow, this water is like really, really green and like really opaque. I probably shouldn't swim here, but I really want to. But oh, I just stepped on a piece of glass. So I'm not maybe the best person to set an example of avoiding toxic algae because I was looking for that spilled paint look and didn't realize till I got home and happened to be seeing on the internet that there was an algae bloom there. I didn't recognize it when I was, even when I was in the water. In case anyone's wondering, nothing bad happened. I just got a smoothie and went to work after the swim. It's fine. So I hope.
All right, next question. So 2 weeks ago, my wife, daughter, and I canoed across Waldo Lake and found that we could make progress against the wind, but could not make any progress with the wind at our back. Can only guess it that it was because of some underwater current. Are you affected by these underwater currents when you're swimming?
Yes. That's such a good question. So actually, during my Waldo swim that I did, not the long one I did recently, but my for fun swim I did with my friend, I was swimming near the shore on the west side near Rhododendron Island. We were kind of swimming up the side of the west side there. And I just noticed that, you know, I'm looking straight at the bottom and I noticed like, wow, I'm really not making much progress here. This is weird. And it seemed like I was almost swimming uphill. Like I could almost see underwater I could see how I was in deeper water and it was getting more and more shallow where I was going to. So I wondered if maybe there was an underwater current there. And I also know that on Lake Tahoe, I did the length last summer and looking at my, like the tracking data and the speed, there are certain parts where you slow way down. And the person who was piloting the boat told me, yeah, this part, it usually people slow down to about half speed right here. And there's an underwater current there. So yeah, it's really interesting that you don't really know that they're there except for when you like, if there's some other way you can tell that you're going slow, but it doesn't feel any different.
All right, here's another question that's related to Waldo Lake. So I've swam once in Waldo Lake during the summer in a shallow sunny spot in a swimsuit and it was nice. Do you recommend using a wetsuit in other parts of the lake?
Yeah, I mean, if wearing a wetsuit takes you to other parts of the lake that you wouldn't go to without the wetsuit, I would say go for it. I mean, it absolutely. I just really, like if there's one take home message today, it's like, you don't have to be doing anything competitive or whatever. You don't have to follow rules or anything. You just do whatever you want out there. There's this whole set of things that if you want to do this ultra swimming or whatever, there's all these rules and stuff that are great, that are really important for that style of swimming. But for just swimming, you can do whatever you want. And I think the lake is just so special that if you can get out into that big blue area wearing a wetsuit, I would say definitely wear it.
Okay, great. So many questions keep coming in. So let's see. Do you know of any Portland area ultra swim groups? I don't know if you just recommend them going to the master classes.
Yeah, I'd say go to masters or go to that. The Portland group, there's a bunch more people in Portland on that Oregon Wild Facebook group than there are anywhere else in the state. And there's tons of little groups that have sort of gotten created from that Facebook group. Like there's kind of people meet each other and then they kind of form their, they call them a pod. It's kind of cute. Form their little pod that, you know, people with maybe similar style of swimming they want to do at a similar time of day and a similar location. So if you're on Facebook, check that out. If you're not, there's an awesome group in Portland called the River Huggers. And I'm so sorry I didn't mention them before, but they are, they're a very welcoming, very inclusive group, and they swim in the Willamette River, and they are oriented toward conservation, helping the river, improving access to the river. They're just a really neat group.
Great, thank you. We still have quite a few questions, so I'll go ahead and extend the webinar a bit. So if you're interested in hearing more answers, hang around. So the next question is, are many people doing downriver swimming? Certainly could be more hazards, but also interesting and exciting. Rocks, rapids, and strainers are most likely the biggest hazards, and you might need a boat. So maybe if you could address that and maybe give us a starter list for rivers that you liked swimming in.
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm actually super, super interested in doing doing more of the Deschutes. And I actually, my friend just texted me, did I want to go on a downriver swim in the Deschutes, like start in Sun River and leave a car? And I can't because I have to work tomorrow. But definitely the Deschutes. It seems like it has a lot of opportunities for that kind of thing. Right now, I can swim downriver from my office up past the Healy Bridge to down by the water park. But I've been thinking about maybe if I could portage myself around certain things, I could like do a really long swim downriver. I did do a long swim in North Dakota on the Red River of the North, the 36-mile downriver swim that took around 11 hours. That river is like super turbid, like really muddy, but really fun and really cool. And that event happens every year. Obviously the Clackamas, there's a down-ish river swim that's an official swim for, called the Portland Bridge Swim from Selwood to St. John's. And I would like to try a downriver swim in the Columbia and like see if I could go a really far distance because it goes so fast. But I really like the idea of doing one that's in a more of like a, you know, where you'd have to logistically figure out how to get around rapids and things like that.
Yeah, thank you for those suggestions. So for folks with some anxiety, it can be about what's in there. Have you actually ever seen anything that surprised you?
Do you really want to know?
That's my question. I do want to know.
Yeah. Okay. Today I saw a coiled up piece of like rope or something. I don't know what it was, but it was a coil of something next to that thing in the river that's like a logging thing. And I thought it was a snake and I like screamed underwater. I haven't seen any bodies. Fish are nice to see. I do have a lot of fears about like what's in there. I try not to think about that too much. I try to just go like, that's not important right now. Like it doesn't need to be answered. It's not what's going on. Try to focus on other things. Nothing too terrible has happened that I can think of right now. I'll let you know if I think something later.
All right, there you go, Jamie. So I think I'm gonna ask probably two more questions. So are there any differences in stroke, et cetera, that are different about open water swimming? And if that's too technical of a question, no problem.
Oh, that's a great question. Some people like to swim with, like if there's a lot of waves or wind chop or whatever, they like to have kind of a higher stroke up than, you know, than they normally would. I don't really make any different changes to it. I think that it's important to think about what your arm is doing underneath the water, not what it's doing above the water. And so if there's a lot of wind and waves and chop or whatever, I just try to focus on what's going on underneath the water. I would say the only other difference is that like in pool swimming, people try to have like one goggle out of the water and one goggle in the water so that you're not lifting your head way out. And I know that sometimes when it gets really choppy, I have to rotate my head further to make sure I don't breathe in a whole bunch of waves. So a few subtle differences, but not anything too big from, in my opinion.
Awesome. So what do you do for nutrition during long swims? I'm pretty curious about this one.
I use Infinite Endurance Blend. People use all kinds of different, you know, like drinks. Drinks are really easy. The drink I have, it has electrolytes and calories in it. And that way I can just drink. I drink about 1 liter an hour, which is a lot more than a lot of people do. I just drink that much because I read that that's how much you can manage to absorb. And I'm a very heavy sweater when I exercise, even in the water. And if you're going for 12 hours, you don't really want to get behind on that. Then sometimes I'll have a Coke at like hour 7. And then I also sometimes have a Cliff Bar, like a builder's bar, if I feel like I need some protein. And then I also drink coffee, and like coffee mixed with hot chocolate if it's cold. But yeah, sometimes people have solid food if it's like a longer swim, but a lot of us just do liquid.
Good to know. All right. I should probably not keep anyone any later. But thank you so much, Jessica. This was a really great webinar. Very informative. It seems like our audience really enjoyed it as well.
Thank you. And if anyone has any other questions that they just really want to, or they want to just like connect, and do contact me through, like, if you go to my blog, OregonLakeBagging.wordpress.com, you can, there's like a contact form. So I'm happy to talk with anyone.
Great. Thank you so much. And thanks to everyone for joining us tonight. Have a great night, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Jessica.